Thank you very much for inviting me and having me speak here. Well, I'm slightly afraid that a previous speaker raised the expectation for what we do in data science somewhat, but I will try my best. Yes, so I work in big data. I will be talking about how big data is different from what we did previously in data analysis. Big data has been as a notion around for a few years only. The Economist was quite timely in 2010 putting out a cover on the data deluge. They didn't even use the word big data very much. There was a famous article in the Harvard Business Review in 2012 where this quote, "the sexiest job of the 21st century," came from, which is actually sort of lifted from our own Helvarian, our chief economist, was saying that the sexy job in the next 10 years will be statisticians, but that's only 4 more years. And of course, The Onion was most timely in 2007 already predicted that one of the worst US jobs in 2049 will be data miner. The interesting thing here is they actually thought data miner was a made-up job. One of the first examples we have, even before it was called big data, of applications of big data was Google Flu Trends. Google Flu Trends was done in 2008, actually ended up in a Nature paper, and it went through sort of our Gartner hype cycle. So the original article was very positive, and then a few years later there were some problems and people figured out how hard it is actually to do, and then you see these titles like disruptions, data without context, tell a misleading story. I don't use the word wrong. What is Google Flu Trends? Google Flu Trends was an attempt to use search data, the queries you type into the Google search engine, to not predict, but to estimate, to measure the incidence of flu-like illness in the population. Measuring the incidence of flu-like illness is extremely important because it helps you to allocate resources in the right way to the right regions in your country. And every year, flu epidemic sweeps to the population of the Northern Hemisphere. And we never know when it starts, how big it will be, do we have enough staff and hospitals to help. The idea from the team there was that even estimating how many people are sick with the flu is difficult, because it used to be done until a few years ago, and especially in 2008, by GPs, general practitioners, doctors, sending fax messages to some sort of local and then central collection agencies like the Center for Disease Control in Atlanta, who would then, about 1 or 2 weeks later, actually know how many people were ill. And 1 or 2 weeks is a long time in a flu epidemic. The idea of the team was to figure out if there was a possibility from people searching for anything around flu at least measure at a given point in time how many people are coming down with the flu. The interesting thing from a big data perspective was that they didn't just go to in the Google Trends, the tools we had at this time, and sort of thought what might people be searching for. They actually used a machine learning approach to figure out which queries actually matched past incidences of flu. So what they did is they took the published data from the CDC for the different regions in the US, there's 9 regions in there, give you weekly data, and match them to a large amount of search queries that might be related, like health-related queries, that might be related to flu trends. And they were looking in the past which of these queries, like treatment for high fever, flu symptoms, high school basketball, would match the previous incidence that was seen of flu in the population. And they were hoping, of course, that this method would pull out the treatment for high fever, the flu symptoms, and not pull out the high school basketball. They then went machine learning through the data and sort of picked like the 50 best they could find, and they created in some sort of a joint estimator from these queries that would try to predict, to measure the incidence of flu. And this is the data they produced, and as you can see, the curve matched relatively well. That worked for most of the time. In 2012, there was then another incident where we actually overestimated. And this shows you one of the central problems when working with big data. The first point about where big data is sort of different from classical data analysis, that at this point they were using a data set that had actually nothing to do with what they wanted to measure. They were using data that we collect to improve the search engine, not to measure illness in the population. They also used a machine learning approach. Basically, at some point, you don't have big data is too big to actually analyze it by hand. So at some point, you enlist the aid of a machine to actually figure out what data to pull. And for this, they had to search in a very, very large data set. We don't really say how many queries we see every day in the search engine, but it's a very, very large number. If you imagine the number of internet users and how many queries people might issue in a day, you get a good approximation. And the, one of the most interesting points, the results in the end are indirect. We were not measuring actually how many people were sick like it would be with hospital admissions. We only were measuring something that turned out in the past to match that number. There's no guarantee that it worked in the future, and there were incidences where this didn't work. Oh, there is actually, so I have the slide. So in 2012, we had this incident where we over-predicted. And this, people think that probably just happened because one of the queries that was in the data set was triggered by news reports, and there were more people searching for this query than in previous years. You can do that yourself now on Google Correlate, which is a public service where you can upload a time series. And the system will look for search queries that match this time series. It's quite interesting. So you'll get a few queries that have something to do with your time series and a lot of other queries that just accidentally match your time structure. Helvarian, our chief economist, has also used that for something he calls nowcasting, which is this idea that just measuring things that happen right now is difficult. He uses it for econometrics, trying to improve economic indicators, which are notoriously difficult to know. Because yeah, usually when you see an economic indicator, it might be for the last quarter, and you don't actually know what's going on right now. And his idea was to combine the actual economic indicators for classical forecast, time series forecasting, with data from searches to improve that. And yeah, got a few percent in improvement in the indicators, which is really, really good for this. I have a second example that's not really to viral marketing, but to politics, football, and tiger ducks. So this is a tiger duck, Tiger Ente in German. It's a little toy, a famous little toy. And we were looking at the search queries for a certain reason of the tiger duck in a week in 2009. And what we saw here was a very, very large peak that happened in a very, very short time period of the evening of the 13th of September 2009. Why were we looking for that? In 2013, I was helping our public relations and policy team in Berlin to analyze search queries that were issued during the federal election campaign in Germany in 2013, and especially for search queries on the evening of the debate of the candidates. We were, of course, hoping that if you looked at search queries, it would help us to understand what people were interested in politics, and it would be easy to see that people were challenged by the topics. But it turned out to be quite difficult, because frankly, these queries are usually swamped out by all the other queries that people, navigational queries, commercial queries, even like pub quiz queries. Not too many people search over the time for political stuff. It's something of a low volume. We had difficulty figuring it out. And then one of the the policy people, they asked me, if I couldn't go back like 4 years, what the debate 4 years previously for the previous elections looked like, and look for the tiger duck. The tiger duck came up in this debate because the 2009 election in Germany were characterized by a big uncertainty about the coalitions. We usually have coalition governments. So we had at least four parties involved in this coalition, so it gives you a lot of possibilities. And we had like the traffic light coalition, red, green, and blue. And there was a Jamaica coalition, which involved a coalition between the black for the conservatives, yellow for the liberals, and green for the environmentalist party, which was a quite challenging idea. But the party, the coalition that won was the coalition that actually governed Germany for a long time, which we usually just refer to as the black-yellow coalition between the conservatives and the liberals. The moderator in the TV discussion on that evening thought that just calling it black-yellow coalition is probably not too much fun. So she was thinking, what's black and yellow? And turned out to refer to it as the Tiger Enten Coalition, the Tiger Duck Coalition. And at that moment, people, actually I have to go to the next slide. In that moment, people went to searches for a few minutes with searching what is actually a tiger duck. Well, most people know, but probably they were asking how many stripes. Is it actually really yellow and black? I always thought it was white and black and things like that. They went to the searches and we get that very, very strong peak. It's basically the strongest peak you see in tiger duck, at least for such a short period of time. That gave us an idea. So instead of trying to figure out manually what queries we are looking at, like I said, it's very difficult even for the flu trends example, why not go and exploit the synchronicity of television? Television is still the only medium that can actually synchronize a large number of people to do the same thing at the same time. So what we did is we went into our data, and then that was done. The example I did was during a game of the 2014 soccer championship, Soccer World Cup of Germany versus Portugal. And we were looking in the data set for these very, very short peaks in search queries. And these are the peaks we found. So each color is a different search query. And as you can see, the peaks that we have detected are all very, very short. There's some that are a bit more spread out. And these are often representing queries that have both peaked in TV, but also are present in general. And this is an interesting list of the queries that we found. And so the interesting thing was, the game started, what people are looking for? The thing that we would have expected that makes some sort of sense is they're looking for the live streams, because jumps on time, so the minute the game starts, they go to the computer and try to figure out, oh my God, how do I watch that? But the top was the top question was the German national anthem, because people, obviously, at the beginning of the game, the national anthem is played and sung, and people seem to try to figure out what the national anthem is right now, if they're playing it right, or if they have the right text. Also very interesting was the last query here, which is asking about how tall Philipp Lahm is, which is one of the German players. At the beginning of the game, the players are standing in line with the team. And that's a moment when it really shows who is tall and who is not tall. And there were enough people to trigger a query to just figure out, who wanted to figure out how tall is this guy actually. So you don't know whether he's tall or not tall. You can then see that the game goes on, and then if you look for during the halftime, interestingly, people during halftime then immediately go into Facebook. So this is a navigational query that we anyway get a lot, but it peaked even at this time, so there were a lot of people more looking for the Facebook. It's just, Facebook is always top query, but at this point it peaked significantly over the previous volume. And I also go to YouTube, Bild, major German newspaper, Kicktip, which is a soccer newspaper, I think. Then there's a commercial break, and that's nice if you're in marketing. So people were actually looking for Edeka, which is a German retailer, or the Galaxy S5 mobile phone. And when the game is over, you could actually see activity being triggered by TV. That was when Michael Schumacher had his accident, and some people were trapped in an underground place and being rescued. And on and on. So basically, we were able with this technique to measure when people were engaged with television. So it's a relatively indirect thing, but that's typical for big data. So what is big data again? What makes it different from previous incarnations of data analysis? The first interesting thing is that you usually use observational data for big data. Normally, social sciences uses when they try to be well. There's observational data in the social sciences, but it's normally qualitative. If you go quantitative and experimental, you have to interact with the subjects, you have to do surveys and ask them, and that's an interaction. It helps you, of course, because if you ask somebody directly, do you like that product? At least you get a clear answer. Big data is normally observational data. These are interactions between users and computers that have been recorded without steering the people in any specific direction. It's also opportunistic in that sense that we're using data that have been collected for other reasons, and that's very typical of big data analyses, because the big data collection happens automatically today. And the big data exploded because we have so many computers around us. Basically, everyone is now carrying a powerful computer connected to the internet with them, and nearly everything is recorded. This is actually an extraordinary situation, especially in social sciences, but also in the other sciences. Getting data was, even if you think about sciences as data-driven, getting data is actually really, really hard. And for a long time, the data collection was the hard part of science. I notice always that when people talk about Thomas Piketty's Capital in the 21st Century, people have lots of different opinions about his conclusions, but they all acknowledge that it's a great scholarly work of data collection. So for economists, and this is just small data, so for economists, even just collecting this data is a big thing. Same is true for even most of the exact sciences. Physicists have an advantage there because we had computers hooked up to our measurements since the 1970s, so we were actually able to create large amounts of data and analyze them. The conclusion from that is often that what you get from big data is circumstantial inference. It's often very hard to get a direct conclusion from the data. It often involves like saying, okay, if all these queries come at the same time, we think they're caused by television, but there's no direct proof except actually looking in the past and looking at the data. So I told you now about the data. Now I wanted to talk a bit about what you should actually be looking in the big data. And if I go to Google Trends, which is like our front interface for big data, and I did that a few days ago from the American website. I don't follow sports very much, but I think all of this is related to American football. And it tells you one of the problems when you look at big data. If you look at the topmost trends, it's usually just driven by media. It doesn't really tell you very much what's going on. I have another example that's much more related to marketing, which is the Krabi sea salt. Sea salt is just salt, potassium chloride for chemists. But if you look at the sea salt price since 2005, they have been continuously rising. And this is normalized to our surge volumes. So have they been rising faster than our general surge volumes? And that's interesting. Because why would people suddenly search for sea salt? Sea salt is an important ingredient if you do artisanal food, as it's called in the US, which means for Americans, good food, foodie culture, slow food. Today it goes like that if you're, that's actually the salt of paradise, is actually what's on the salt shaker in one of our cafeterias at Google. I'm not quite sure what it is, but it tastes pretty good, but it's mostly salt. I got this example from Grant McCracken, who's an anthropologist who writes books about marketing. And he looked at the development of artisanal food in the United States over since the 1970s. Artisanal food started in the mid-1970s in Berkeley with a restaurant called Chez Panisse. Before that, people were actually quite happy to buy conserved food, processed food. That was very much modern in the 50s and 60s. And the fact that today, it's very probably different in France, but in the US, it's the fact that today we think that food should be fresh and as little processed as possible, that our cafeterias had all the little like poetry about how they cold the food, that comes from a movement that started in Berkeley in the 1970s. And Grant wrote a book that he calls Culture-matic. He calls these things Culture-matics. These are like clusters of things in culture that lastingly change things. And that translates to the analysis of trends. So I'd like to call what sea salt is and the whole cluster around artisanal food a deep trend, which is a trend that actually reflects a structural change in the underlying population. That's what you would like to look for. Deep, slow trends that actually change the structure of your customers or your users. What you see on top of that, that would have to filter out, is often just media driven. These are short attention spans. Things that people tied in because they see it on TV that don't actually tell you very much about the people. In that sense, big data is a microscope into the underlying data set and the population that has generated that. And having more data is what scientists would call having a higher luminescence that usually allows you to see more detail in the data. An example is what we do in physics at CERN. This is a picture from the ATLAS experiment that discovered the if they say they discovered something, it's usually not that they actually saw something in one single event. It means they have started billions of events and have found out that at a certain cut in the data, there's a 3 or 6 sigma excess of something that cannot be explained by conventional experiments. And these conclusions can only be taken because you have lots of these events. And that's what statistics has always been doing. The more data you have, the less noise you have. So how do you find structure in data? That means that the tools we use today are a combination of machine learning and statistics. And we wanted to, in the last part of my talk, I wanted to go about one tool that I think will be very important for that. Statistics and machine learning are interesting because they come from two different perspectives. Statisticians usually try to put as much prior knowledge into a model as possible. They're really well trained about getting the right model and then at some point focusing on just estimating the remaining parameters they can't guess. Machine learners think often the completely other way around. They think that a computer should deduce as much as possible and you should put as little as you can of human previous knowledge in there. Both approaches have their merits. The problem in big data is often that you need to combine both of them, especially if you're looking like in this trends business for things that you don't know where they are. But it's difficult. Luckily, this has been done before and several times, and I wanted to show two examples where this happened before. Turns out that many of the people in our team are actually bioinformaticians, and I was in bioinformatics before and gave this talk at a different conference, met like 3 of my former students there. In the late 1990s, biology had their own big data problem. Biology used to be a small data science, maybe not even a really very quantitative science. But in the late 1990s, with this genome sequencing gearing up, there was suddenly the possibility to do what's called gene expression analysis. A gene expression analysis allows you to look at the activity of the of genes and of all genes in your genome in an organism, and measure them at certain instance in time or with certain external conditions. And this is a measurement. And this is a really big data. It's dozens of megabytes for bioinformaticians. This is really big data. The columns are the genes. And the colors mean, so each column is one measurement of all of a genes over different conditions. The rows are the conditions. So each row is one experiment with 6,000 genes have been measured. Green means that gene was more active than normally. Red means it was less active than normally. And that's the data that came out of it. Now, problem is, that doesn't tell us very much. Biologists classically would know each of the proteins encoded by these genes very well and then try to follow one or two or three of these proteins and see how they change. We're looking at this, that's not easy to come up with. And it also wasn't helped by the fact that, well, bioinformaticians came mostly not from biology, but from physics and mathematics, and also didn't actually know any of these proteins. So the big idea that several people came up with in the late 1990s was to use something called cluster analysis. And it's very interesting that cluster analysis actually goes back a long time into the first half of the 21st century. This is a very similar graph. To the previous graph from a paper of Driver and Alfred Kroeber from 1932, who fittingly were Kroeber was the first professor of anthropology at the University of Berkeley. They were looking at the quantitative expression of cultural relationships. What they were doing here is the columns again are the objects. In this case, it's not the genes, but they are the they're different tribes in northern Peru, and the rows are different properties of these tribes as they had been classified by a previous paper that's actually in German, from a German paper. And they were creating the same matrix that Timothy Fisher did in 2000 in this experiment with yeast in 1932. And you read the paper, they're actually complaining that they had to like stop at 30 tribes because that meant they had to calculate nearly 500 coefficients by hand. But they did that. In the end, they did some clustering, so they were looking for the for similarities in this data, and they basically, and they emphasized that they could, without actually interpreting, they could sort of recreate the spatial distribution of these tribes, basically proving the tribes that were close on the map were also close together in this state space of similarity of their of what they. What they did. And they also found that, for example, there's something marked C, clusters that didn't fit, that sort of put them that something was wrong. Okay. How does that translate today to quantitative marketing? So cultural activity today is primarily television, at least in the United States. And we did something, as is, like just an exploratory analysis, for example, of TV watching, and we were just looking this in the same way we did the matrix, where we have users and we have shows. We were looking for similarities between users. We put users that watch similar show in a similar group. We're looking what we got. And if you look at this, perhaps if you're American here, but if you look at the first of the Doc McStuffins, Mickey Mouse Clubhouse, Jake and the Neverland Pirates, Paw Patrol, that's a young child. That's a seven-year-old. The other cluster of fine friends is Austin and Ally, Casey Undercover, Girl Meets World, there's Thundermans. If you know American TV, that's a teenager. And then the last thing, that, for example, has True Detective, The Big Bang Theory, that's not a children's show. So this is an adult. So we can, even just from looking at these clusters without actually knowing anything about demographics, deduce something. And I think this will be a very important technology in the future for analyzing data, because it allows you to sort of automatically find interesting structures in data instead. And it gets these methods, and when we did these methods in the late 2000s, we were very much constrained by computing power. Today, we have much more computing power in the cloud available. The interesting thing is now that the big problem in this is feature selection. We have a huge number of features now, the things, which are important, which are not. But we have more and more methods now by just repeating the clustering, trying different clustering, basically doing statistics on top of machine learning to elucidate these contexts. So that's my last slide. I just want to I try to convince you that big data is different from much data. It's a change from quantity into quality. It's not unusual. In physics, we call that complexity. Physics suffers from the problem that the underlying laws of physics are the same for everything, from atomic matter to people in biology. And the explanation, just if you have more and more atoms, you get things look completely different. It's very similar with big data. If you have more and more data, you have the ability to go deeper and deeper and to see more and more. And that's, in the end, So not everything is big data, but you can do new things with big data, and that's in the end what we want to do as scientists. Thank you.